Well, since I'm up here, I'd like to say just a brief little introduction about our next segment. Thank you, Ross. About 15 years ago, I met Nick Hess, someone who helped open my eyes to some really important perspectives that greatly improved the trajectory of my life. But enough about me. Nick is a native-born Atlantan and Georgia Tech graduate. While at Tech, some friends introduced him to the Madhousers, a group of students and activists who construct tiny, walkable, weather-resistant structures for homeless people and give them away for free. His life has never been the same since. Please give a warm welcome to my friend, Nick Hess.
Thank you. I'm going to feel weird talking into this thing. I've got kind of a big voice. Can everybody hear me? Okay, awesome. Thank you all for having me over here, and I will try and keep this to within 20 minutes. My name is Nick Hess, and I build boxes. I don't just build boxes for the Madhousers. My job, I'm a software architect, so what I do is I cut big problems into little problems and make sure that those problems fit inside their boxes. That's what I do. So why, this might be sort of a strange question, or sort of a strange thought, why do we have boxes, right? Why do we have the boxes with the life happens in it? Now, we have boxes because a box allows us to concentrate on what's inside the box and ignore the things that are on the outside of the box, right? So this is a good thing. I mean, we in this church that we're in is a box, right? And inside of it, we have other boxes. We have a kitchen. We have a bathroom, right? We worry about some things in the kitchen and other things in the bathroom, right? We don't mix those up. So this is good. But just because something is ignored doesn't mean that it stops existing, right? So let's bring this back over to the Housers. We've got people who live outside. And what does this mean? It means that we as a society have decided to ignore these people and their problems. But history has shown that this is a terrible idea. Our greatest atrocities happen when we decide to ignore the welfare of others. Whether it's us deciding that, you know, it's okay to put people in reservations and box, right? Or of course, the Holocaust, or in the opposite direction, when somebody who was on the outside decides to come back inside, like in the tragic event that was last week, with a grudge, right? So, I build boxes. They're small, but in them, a person can concentrate on themselves, and at least for a while, ignore the problems outside. The problems will, of course, still be there, but everybody needs a respite. One of the things that we'd like to say over in the Housers is that even jerks, although that's not the word I use, even jerks need a place to stay, right? And maybe if you have some place where you can forget about your problems for a while, maybe you can work on becoming a better person or solving those problems. Madhousers, I didn't start it. It started 30 years ago, actually, 1987. It was a group of architecture grad students. I got drawn into it. I had some friends, and they were doing it, and then I started doing it. And around 2000, I sort of graduated from being a hammer swinger and sort of an advocate to running the organization, because at that time there was very little organization left to run. 17 years later, I have stepped down. I'm very proud of what I've done. The organization is healthy. We didn't have a place then. We didn't have enough money to keep a bank account. We didn't have a phone number. Now we're consistently coming out. We are helping people. We've got a permanent place to stay. We've got donors, and this year, for the first time, because the Hausers is an all-volunteer organization, for the first time, we are going to hire some staff so we can help more people out. A big scary step into the unknown for us, but you can't let being scared stop you from getting out. So, for building these boxes, these little shelters, it's helped my life tremendously. And the Hausers have been honored. I've been flown to museums, including one in Milan, of all places, the Cooper Hewitt Design Museum. We've been to publications, we've been news articles about us, and invitations to speak, right? And, that's nice, but it's not really the point, and it's not enough. Over the course of 25-odd years of helping, working in the Hausers, I've helped hundreds of people. But as I speak tonight, there are thousands of people still outside, right? We must expand our mental boundaries so that we include everybody inside of our society. We have decided to ignore these folks, ignore their problems, but they're not gone. They're still there. So I feel that it's a moral imperative for us to extend our vision to stop ignoring people and think about this particular set of problems. Now, I say let's bring people inside, that doesn't mean that we allow any behavior, right? I mean, remember, inside means that we've restricted what's going on. We've focused on a particular activity. If we say, all right, we're going to try and bring you back into the fold, that means that you can't go around and set things on fire or whatnot. But it's not like there's some sort of real place where people can escape, some sort of unclaimed space outside where a person can be free from the law. They're still under our ambit, which is one of my favorite 50 cent words right there. They're still under our responsibility. We've just decided collectively to ignore that responsibility. It doesn't mean that trying to do this is going to be easy. If it was easy, it would already be solved now, wouldn't it, right? And it doesn't mean that we're going to get it right. Being human means that we're going to get it wrong, right? But that's okay. We only learn from trying. We only get better from trying. Lastly, nobody is going to be like, oh my god, that lecture was too short.
I have a picture from when we volunteered.
Yeah, and I can do some Q&A as well. Lastly, it doesn't mean that it won't be scary. Any time that you bring the outside inside, there's going to be a risk. There's going to be an expense. But the risk was always there. We just ignored it. It didn't disappear. So, I'm going to give you an assignment. Right now, in your life, there is some problem that you are ignoring. Right? And I charge you to get started with it. Start small if you have to, but start. Now, I'm going to allow some. Disallow some other things. I give you permission to be afraid, but I don't give you permission to run away. I give you permission to be wrong, but I don't give you permission to continue to be wrong. Right? I give you permission to set limits on what you're doing, what you can do. In fact, I encourage you to keep yourself sane and healthy. Trust me, don't be like me. But don't forget about what is outside of those limits. The future is never guaranteed to us. don't know what's going to happen when we try things, but we have an obligation to try nonetheless. And this is where we leave behind planning, and we leave behind logic, and we leave behind guarantees, and we operate in that nebulous area that we call faith, even in a secular organization. Faith is the act of climbing the stairs in the dark and understanding or believing that that next step is going to be there. This is my charge, and I hope that you'll take it up. Thank you very much.
We've got like 10 minutes here. So.
Okay, great. So we've got two basic styles of structures, the short and the tall, the vente and the long. That's a tall right there. That's, so this is called a hi-hat. It is a modification of our original old-style hut. It is 6 foot by 8 foot on the ground with a 6 foot by 6 foot loft in it, and a salt box roof up on the top. So you can't see it in that photograph. But it is, there's a row of windows up along the top to allow additional light and ventilation. So that's about 84 square feet all told. It also comes with an optional wood-burning stove that we also manufacture, right? So we have the short one, which is we call the low rider. That's a 4 foot by 8 foot, so it's a single piece of plywood, and it's 4 foot. This is for people for whom a tall structure would get them in trouble, because it wasn't really explained in the little introduction, but the way that the houses operate is, we find existing homeless encampments where people have been out there for a while. You know, everybody knows, you know, old Bob there, that, you know, he's drunk every day, but he's not a problem every now and again. You know, he has to go off the pokey or he's mowing lawns and things like that. We're here to help Bob, right? And so if Bob is staying someplace and he's not causing problems, and us building him a shelter isn't going to cause a problem for Bob, then that's where we do it, right where he's already at. Because we reckon that Bob knows what's best for Bob, you know? He has chosen that place because it is working for him. Now what we're helping him do is stabilize, keep his possessions safe, keep himself safe, so that he doesn't have to worry about surviving today, because he's got today in hand. Now he can start thinking about tomorrow, right? Because civilization itself is based upon, is predicated upon, the idea that you can build a better tomorrow. But if you don't have a tomorrow, if it's only an everlasting now, there's no real point in trying. So, as the old saying goes, it's not what you have, it's what you keep. Yes, sir.
So what's the typical lifespan of one of these shelters? I imagine it probably could withstand, you know, 40, 50, 60 years or something. but zoning requirements?
Got it. We have had some of these structures, I mean, they'll stay intact for 10 years without any maintenance whatsoever. I will get to you in just a sec. And one of the reasons actually why we are moving to having a hired staff is that, you know, these were supposed to be emergency shelters, temporary structures, and we have some folks who are dying in them, of old age and health problems and things like that. And it's like, okay, I guess it means dying on the street, but really that's pretty weak tea, right? So we've been all volunteer all this time. We have daytime jobs and, you know, other concerns. And so we just needed to have somebody to help us bring this additional services that people need to the chronically homeless. You know, help connect people so that we're not just moving them into the huts, but we're moving them back out of the huts. Yes, miss.
It looks like you made it out soon when you see, like, the end
picture.
Oh,
it's just paint. So, and what that is, that's Hauser's camo. So what we do is that we'll sit here and we'll take any half-empty can of paint, and then we blend them together, you know, big things of color, you know, called blob, right? It's like, okay, that's blue blob, that's brown blob. It's also sexy. And what we'll do is that we will pour one color in a pan and then pour a line of the other color in a pan, but we don't mix it. We just roll it, and then when you roll it on, you get these patterns on there to help break up the sun. Now, we have a lot of places, and more nowadays, people are coming around, probably, where we're on somebody's land with explicit permission. I know Bob. Bob's a local character. He can stay in my backyard. And in that case, what we'll do is we'll make a grid. You know, so if you know a law, you know, or maybe you have a relative, a cousin, or somebody who every now and again, you know, falls off the wagon, and you don't want to bring them in the house, but you know, you don't want them outside either. We've helped in situations like that. You know, this really. Guys, it's really weird to me that we've gotten so much kudos, and yet this is literally, I think, the least that we could be doing for people. Is providing a shack. And for that, I'm going to New York, I'm going to Milan. Like this was times. You know. So now I just very quickly, you know, I have stepped down as the president of the Hauser's, you know, it's in a healthy place, and I am actually beginning to work with and hopefully in the city. I ran for city council because this is a case where we need to stop thinking about helping people individually, onesies, twosies. The community will take care of it. The church will take care of it. We need to start thinking about policy. Right? And it's one that is more human, that includes everybody who falls under the law, should also be given.